Welcome to this week's episode of FFRF's Ask an Atheist. I'm Andrew Seidel.
I'm Patrick Elliott.
And I'm Elizabeth Cavell. We're all attorneys here at FFRF, and we're suing the Trump administration again. And our new lawsuit is about this.
It's been called the most evangelical cabinet in history. Men and women who don't mince words when it comes to where they stand on God and the Bible.
These are godly individuals that God has risen to a position of prominence in our culture.
All handpicked by President Donald Trump and Vice President Mike Pence.
I don't think Donald Trump's figured out that he chained himself to the Apostle Paul.
Ralph Drolinger is a
misogynist. In a Bible study lesson for California legislators, he once wrote that it is sinful for women to work outside the home. Drolinger also said that Roman Catholicism is one of the primary false religions in the world.
No fan of the Catholic Church, but all religions are equally false. Drolinger also attacked social welfare programs as unbiblical, unchristian, and based on, quote, the bad theology of theological liberalism, whatever that might be. And of course, he thinks that homosexuals are, quote, an abomination. Drolinger has unprecedented access and influence and is using both to spread a virulent strain of Christian nationalism.
Like Jeff Sessions, he'll go out the same day I teach him something, and I'll see him do it on camera. And I just think, man, these guys are faithful, available, and teachable, and they're at Bible study every week they're in town.
Teachable, that's a scary word. According to reports, Drolinger has access to nearly all of the top leaders. Teachable are easily influenced leaders. Vice President Mike Pence, co-sponsors of the Bible study, and most of the secretaries attend, including Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, CIA Director Mike Pompeo, Energy Secretary Rick Perry, and Ben Carson. Trump is rumored to skip the studies.
So one of the problems is that this Bible study and Drolinger's access is cloaked in secrecy. We don't really know what's going on behind the closed doors of our government. And in a democracy which depends on transparency, that's a problem. So we're going to talk about that lawsuit today in the context of one of the unsung heroes of our legal work. Every year, FFRF gets between 4,000 and 5,000 complaints about state church issues.
And often, something sounds like a violation, but we need more information. That was the case with the White House Bible study, which we first heard about over the summer. A White House Bible study definitely sounds unconstitutional, but we would have to review what's actually going on here. To be sure, we wanted to know more. As Andrew explained to Fox and Friends.
Andrew, I will start with you. The name of your foundation is Freedom From Religion. However, when you read the First Amendment, it talks about freedom of religion. Why would these leaders not have the ability in a country with a lot of faith-filled people to simply host a Bible study?
Well, look, there are two major concerns here, right? There's the legality and the propriety of this. So first, these are government officials on government property using government resources on the taxpayer time getting together for a religious purpose. And that raises several issues. You know, what is the extent of the government resources being used? Are staffers pressured or coerced into attending? And
you,
the Freedom
you
from
believe
Religion
that
Foundation
these cabinet
has
members
actually
are
submitted
being,
a number.
Do you believe they're being coerced?
No, I'm saying that this is something we don't. I'm saying that this is something we don't know, and we've actually submitted records requests to attempt to determine the extent of any possible violations. But if you leave the legalities aside, the propriety here, I mean, it can't be considered proper or in keeping with American values for government officials to get together on taxpayer time to study a book that condones slavery and the subjugation of women and the eternal torture and torment of people who don't believe like you. So
well,
even if it doesn't violate the Constitution directly, it certainly violates that core principle of American government, the separation of state and church.
So, Andrew, that was a great appearance on Fox and Friends, and you've got to stop conforming to the angry atheist stereotype. But did you actually ever indeed request those records that you mentioned in the clip?
So we actually did. Using the Freedom of Information Act, FOIA, we requested records from every single department that was reportedly involved in the Bible lessons. To date, we actually haven't seen a single record, and it's been more than 4 months now.
Now, these requests can take a long time, and they can also cost a lot of money. But when the request is coming from a 501c3 and concerns matters of public interest, such as whether the government is violating the Constitution, all those fees usually must be waived. And while we haven't seen any records yet, we have been granted fee waivers before, including by, for instance, the Department of Education, run by Betsy DeVos. And denying a fee waiver allows the government to charge what can often be exorbitant fees for records, making it that much more difficult for a nonprofit to get those records.
But Ben Carson's Department of Housing and Urban Development stubbornly refused to grant the fee waiver. They denied it and we appealed, which was also denied. And we actually noticed that the Housing and Urban Development was denying fee waivers to other organizations as well, including CRU, which is Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington.
CRU had been denied a fee waiver for records relating to nepotism in the department. Ben Carson's son and his wife seem to have undefined but omnipresent roles at HUD, and CRU wanted to know more, so they made FOIA requests for those records. CRU was also looking for any records relating to Carson's use of private planes, an issue that has plagued the administration. HUD denied fee waivers on both those requests.
So I reached out to CRU and explained that we, too, had been denied these fee waivers. I also explained that we were looking for records relating to Carson's participation in another religious event, this time at the Museum of the Bible. Carson spoke at Revive Us 2, a religious worship service hosted by the discredited child actor Kirk Cameron.
But you and I know something they don't. An awakening has begun. There's been a shift in our culture. A fresh momentum is building. God is unleashing something that is uniting heaven and earth. And what God joins together, nothing can separate. Join me and Dr. Ben Carson, Johnny Erickson Tata, Ravi Zacharias, Alex and Stephen Kendrick, producers of the movies Fireproof and War Room, special artists and musical guests Zach Williams and Christian Cuevas, as we gather on one night live in theaters across the country to pray and worship together. And
yikes. So if Carson's using government staff and resources to participate in a worship service, that's a constitutional problem. So we requested those records and HUD denied our fee waiver. So after all those denials, CRU and FFRF sued Carson's Department of Housing and Urban Development. But the lawsuit isn't over the Bible study itself, it's about access to records. And what many people don't realize is how crucial FOIA and state open records laws are to FFRF's work. Last year, we sent 84 records requests on various issues.
So we often request records to schools who are promoting or having churches rent their classrooms, about prayer breakfasts. We've requested records about a jail that allowed 600 citizens to come in and pray over the inmates. This was in Kentucky, and stay tuned for some more news about that. We often request records about school curricula. Often, we think there might be a violation and are able to stop it with those particular records. And one of my favorite examples of this happened with a Bible class in Mustang, Oklahoma, that the Hobby Lobby family was sponsoring. And once we got the records, it became clear that the curriculum was absurd, and we were actually able to get it stopped simply by pointing out how bad it was. In this picture right here, you can actually see they are talking about the artifacts from the Bible that have yet to be discovered, including Noah's Ark, the Holy Grail, and Moses's magic wand down there in the bottom right. We also found out that with that Hobby Lobby Bible class that the school was actually not complying with open meetings laws. They were having secret meetings at the Hobby Lobby headquarters in violation of state law.
So that's just one example of how and when we've used requests for open records to figure out what's going on, establish that there's a constitutional violation, and get it stopped, either with or without a lawsuit. And one example that I work on pretty frequently here is also, you kind of alluded to it, which is prayer breakfasts. Mm-hmm. This is a situation where in lots of cities and towns all over the country, many people have heard of this, there's something like a mayor's prayer breakfast or a governor's prayer breakfast, and it's You know, it's a hobnobbing event where usually you buy tickets for a table, you come for a meal, there's a motivational speaker, and, you know, it's all over the spectrum in terms of the religiosity of the event, but it's usually, obviously, centered around prayer, the power of prayer, and that type of thing. So just two examples of times where I've sent records requests regarding mayor's prayer breakfasts, both in California. One was in the city of Lakewood, one was in Buena Park, California. And this is a tool that we often use when we hear about a prayer breakfast that's just called the mayor's prayer breakfast, because oftentimes there's private 501c3s committees that are organized to put on these breakfasts. So they're purportedly privately sponsored events, but there's always sort of a clue about some type of government involvement, like it says, you know, you can purchase tickets at City Hall or call this number for more information, and it's a number that's a city number. And so we really need to know what the details are, how the government's involved, what types of resources are being used to plan and organize this event.
So if it were, for instance, a completely private organized event and they were just renting, say, the hall or a room in City Hall, we might not have a problem. But if they are using all those city resources and they're having city staff doing it, that's what we're looking for in the
records.
Right,
that's right. So whether or not it amounts to a violation that we can get involved in depends really on the nitty-gritty of the details and what government resources are being used, if any. And so really the only way to get at that, because usually these prayer breakfasts are, when you see outward advertisements, they are sponsored by a private organization. So we send records requests under state law asking for any government records, including emails and things like that, that relate in any way to the planning of the mayor's prayer breakfast. And in Lakewood, California, and Buena Park, California, both, I got, you know, a stack of 200 to 400 records. And it really just, it's mostly emails, but also financial records. It's emails and emails of city staff coordinating all year every detail of these prayer breakfasts. You know, they're booking speakers, they're booking travel for speakers, they're taking ticket sales, they're assigning people at tables, they're sending, you know, 400 emails a year just about the details of planning this prayer breakfast. And sending 400 emails a year is a lot of city resources and time. And so both of those cities, after complying with these records requests and sort of being forced to reckon with this huge stack, which is just a visual representation of like money and time wasted, have both also agreed that they need to sort of divest their city involvement from this event and turn the planning and all the responsibility over to these private committees that are supposed to be hosting the event.
So basically you got two victories just by requesting the records.
Right, exactly.
And I think that people don't realize that emails really are public records when they're coming to and from a government official. And that's something that's so effective for us and one of the things that we're requesting in the FOIA for
right.
HUD.
And it's a means of addressing state church violations. So one thing is, you know, we have a right as citizens to know how our government is acting, you know, both under the Freedom of Information Act federally, and every single state in the U.S. allows access to records that people can request. So one of my favorite examples of addressing a school system that we knew was violating the Constitution, which relates to records, is a number of years ago I requested I sent a complaint about religious posters in a public classroom. This is from a school in Wisconsin where they had posters up about John 3:16, the Ten Commandments, Genesis, a number of religious posters. We knew that this classroom for one period in the day was used for a Bible course, but the rest of the day was used for other school activities. And so having these posters up definitely were a problem. So we sent the complaint and received a response back from the school system that basically said, oh, you're misunderstanding this. These posters are a part of our curriculum. They're integrated into our curriculum. And so I'm thinking, this is very interesting, because I don't know how you incorporate John 3:16 into...
Yeah, what part of your public school
right,
curriculum
right.
is
so John 3:16? Right, so this is where the records request comes in. So we requested records saying, oh, we'd like to see your curriculum that relates to these types of posters. And so we got a response back basically saying, we've removed the posters.
So just asking for the records was enough to kill the
right,
violation.
Right.
So this is a really powerful tool that we use. And it's something that is, it is, as you said in the beginning, kind of one of the unsung heroes of FFRF's legal work. And when I went back to look up the number of how many we submitted, I was so surprised that we had almost, you know, almost 100, 84 last year.
So every week, at least, we're yeah. asking for information from some government entity. I expect that's likely to go up because I think oftentimes that is crucial, like Liz said, to knowing what's really going on. If the government can operate secretly, it can violate the First Amendment secretly, too.
And especially in a democracy, it's just a must. Now, we're going to take a few questions, so if you have questions about how we use records requests or records laws, go ahead and ask them below. Our first question is from Doug Roberts, who said, I'm interested to hear your thoughts about the latest attempt to give health workers the right to refuse treatment on religious grounds. So I think Doug there is referring to the new division at the HHS, the Health and Human Services, that was created, that is the, I don't remember the exact name, but it's basically the Religious Freedom Division that is essentially going to be allowing, taking on cases and complaints from workers in health fields who say, I don't want to serve a trans patient, or I don't want to take, I don't want to, you know, lay an IV in somebody when they're going to be doing an abortion on that person later on. So they have religious objections to their work in the healthcare field, and they're going to be able to complain to HHS about that now. I think it's kind of scary.
I mean, I think it's a disaster from the perspective of healthcare for people who have a right to healthcare. I mean, this isn't, we're not talking about gratuitous, I'm going to attend an entertainment event. I mean, this is relates directly to people's healthcare, and it also relates directly to employment. I mean, what are hospitals to do when somebody for their own bigotry doesn't want to treat a particular patient? I mean, that creates, I think this is Scalia who said it, you know, there's a law unto themselves. I mean, are people all now going to decide what they think is best rather than, you know, a hospital policy related to, of course, you know, we have to treat patients for certain conditions. And I think it goes beyond, you know, even just this touch on a couple of issues, you know, whether it's treating a transgender patient for gender reassignment surgery or treating somebody for abortion. The real world medical, you know, procedures are a lot more complicated than that. Somebody who has a complication in their birth, maybe they would want tubal ligation. You know, is there some other aspects that come up where people are now going to deny care because they have an objection? I mean, I think this process itself violates the Establishment Clause to give religious employees special protection when all other employees don't get to decide, you know, who they treat and who they don't treat.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Right. Riffing off what Patrick said, I mean, it's just the expansion and the crazy running amok of this idea that individual religious believers have a right, a free exercise right, to both violate oftentimes the law or, you know, the standard of care in an industry or their own rules of medical professionalism and oaths, professional oaths. You know, they have a right to just ignore those things that they don't wish to follow to the detriment of third parties and harming other people and violating other people's rights to comprehensive health care in the process. And not only is it just crazy and unfair and dangerous, but it violates the Establishment Clause to treat religious believers as special citizens who don't have to comply with the law.
And it's part of this overall attempt that we're seeing lately to redefine religious liberty, which is something that we've been arguing about, you know, turning it from that shield, that personal protection, into a weapon that allows you to impose that religion on others. And we actually issued a statement the day this news broke, Wednesday last week, I believe. So if anybody wants to go check that out on the FFRF website, they can do that. In the meantime, we had a question from Twitter, which is, if atheists don't believe in God, then why would they care about the Bible study?
I mean, I'll take the start of this. Andrew probably has more to share. I mean, one thing interesting specific to this Bible study with Capital Ministries is it is meant to influence policy. I mean, there's discussions of, one of the things, if you go to the website, is a talk about the national debt. What does the Bible say about debt? So the top levels, people in our government, the top officials, are getting their policy decisions via somebody's interpretation of this book. So, I mean, it's a really big deal as somebody who's an atheist and somebody who doesn't want how our government to be run like a theocracy. I mean, it's a really big deal what the Bible, how people interpret the Bible, what they're using it for. So I think the fact that there's a Bible study here is really important, and everybody should be concerned about it.
That's a great point. That's a great point. And these evangelical leaders have bragged, and as you heard Drollinger signaling, you know, the entire point is look at this unprecedented access that we have and this opportunity we have to influence policy by, you know, influencing our leaders and, you know, teaching them because they're so teachable. So that's a huge point. But also, we atheists don't believe in God, but we do pay taxes. And, you know, these people are elected and are being paid by all of us taxpayers, even the non-believers, and using government time and resources when you should be governing to get together and, you know, study this evangelical Christian version of the world is just wrong, and it's unconstitutional depending on, you know, when it's being done and with what resources and how.
Yeah, and I mean, that's the overall point for me is this is unconstitutional in all likelihood. We're trying to get the records to figure it out, but, you know, if the Constitution is being violated, that is a concern for every single American. I mean, we suspect that's happening. We know it's happened in other respects with this particular administration, but they also have violated federal law. They completely violated the Freedom of Information Act. This is going to be a fairly quick case, I hope. So, you know, we have a government that is ignoring their mandate, the Constitution, and ignoring federal law. That should concern every single citizen, not just people who happen to not believe in this book, which is a good book not to believe in, and also a pretty bad book if you want to govern. I mean, slavery is recognized twice in the Ten Commandments. Women are treated as chattel in the Ten Commandments. You know, this is not a book that we really want our highest levels of government to be using as a guidepost for social policy. So that's my two cents on that one. So we have another question. This one is from Charles Clark. He asks, what if people pushed Quran readings at the White House alongside the Bible readings? What do you think would happen?
I mean, that would probably bother enough people that maybe this would, you know, obviously would get knocked off. But it also, I mean, I don't know if this person's making a serious suggestion, but this is a common refrain sometimes that I think we see on state church issues, which is, it just so happens that all of these eight cabinet leaders are Christians, so that's why there's this Bible study. Or alternatively, an argument that I don't like that we hear sometimes is, oh, we can just throw more religion on of different types, and that would make it okay. And in a pluralistic, if they had, you know, Hebrew Bible reading and Christian Bible reading and the Quran Bible reading, it would all still not be okay. I mean, the fact that they're doing religion on government time, seeming to be a high-level government meeting, you're going to take eight, you know, the Vice President of the United States and seven cabinet members having a meeting on a weekly basis, that's a pretty big deal. I mean, their schedules are obviously jam-packed. So the fact that it's Christian or if it was Muslim, it doesn't really matter to us. I feel like it's the overall scheme here that's a problem.
Yeah. And I think, you know, this is one thing that we kind of always use, sort of an argument we always use is, if you are a Christian and don't think that this could violate the Constitution, just imagine if they were having a weekly Quran study, or instead of a national day of prayer, it was a national day of prayer to Allah. You know, we use this argument to kind of help people understand why it would be a problem when they're in the majority and don't really get it. We have another question here. This is Rayanne. She asks, much as I agree with this lawsuit, more serious issues come to mind. DeVos is doing more damage to separation of church-state, state-church separation, than Carson. Don't you think you should pick better fights?
I mean, you know, I guess I disagree with the premise in the question that sure. we're not addressing some other things. Certainly, here, if there's a pattern in practice, which is what this case is about, is basically members of the media and nonprofit groups can't get information from our federal government, that is a big deal. I mean, how are we going to find out what our government's doing if we can't do it? So I do think it's really important. Obviously, issues with the Secretary of Education and her ultimate goal of creating a federal voucher system are a problem. I mean, I can just speak to some of the efforts that FFRF has taken on that.
You're really taking vouchers head on, and FFRF has been huge on that for years, but you're kind of the point person
right.
on that.
And I mean, we've actually had lobbying meetings in Washington, and as it seems right now, there is, I guess, bipartisan opposition to the idea of creating a federal voucher system, and we've been gathering information and sharing information about why that is such a horrible idea. Thankfully, so far, she hasn't been able to institute a lot of the policies she wants. But I guess I would just say DeVos is a threat. We opposed her nomination. We've done a lot in regards to educating the public as well as elected leaders about bad policies, you know, funding religious education. I think it is a huge issue. But that doesn't mean we have to let other government officials to just not disclose information to the public, which we have the right to.
Absolutely. And I think one other thing that people really ought to be cognizant of is that oftentimes these little violations, you know, little, lead to and justify bigger violations in the future. I've given a whole talk on this. I think we did a whole episode of Ask an Atheist on it. It's called Why We Should Sweat the Small Stuff. So Rayanne should go check that out. But oftentimes these little things, like a White House Bible study, are used to justify much bigger and more problematic violations. You have to, as James Madison said, take alarm at the first experiment on your liberties, not wait till it's well established and entrenched.
And yeah, we're getting stonewalled on records during our pursuit of a really important constitutional issue, and you know we pick. There's nothing sexy about our open records law lawsuit, but you know, like Pat said, transparent government is absolutely essential to a free democracy. But also, you know, we have to pick battles and make decisions, but we pick all the battles that come to us. I mean, you know, we're being thwarted in violation of open records law, and so, you know, the battle picks us. I mean, the wand chooses the wizard sometimes, and you know,
Moses's magical wand chooses the wizard. I mean, I think, but you're right. If it's a violation of federal law or of the Constitution, we're going to go after it. That's our bar, and if it meets that bar, we're gonna go after it, no matter how big or small. So we have Jesse Brock actually said, I noticed you mentioned a jail in Kentucky that had a prayer program for inmates. And you said stand by for an update on that. Will we be providing an update during the live show? We probably will be providing an update on it. If you're signed up for FFRF or if you are a member, you will get all the updates. If you're not a member, you really ought to go join. We absolutely need your support, especially given this administration and all the violations that are coming in that we're tackling. But you will almost certainly hear about it. So we have one final question that's not related, which is what books are you reading right now, and what do you recommend?
I'll start because I'm not as heavy of a reader as I know Andrew is. I'm a news person. I read a lot of news. I'm midway through, and I'm not that far in Just Mercy. The book that I just grabbed, which I need to actually read, it more relates to work FFRF does, but I think it's called How Judges Think, by Richard Posner. So I have the hard copy of that I think can guide our work a little bit. And I think that's an interesting insight from somebody who's somewhat of a conservative judge. I think it's an interesting perspective to see what he says. And he's not been shy about sharing his opinions on the judiciary. So I think I'll enjoy that.
I'm going to have to borrow that after you're done.
Just Mercy is a great book. By great, I mean horrifically sad and illustrative of humongous problems. I just finished The Glass Castle. It's a memoir by Jeanette Walls, a really, really good book. And I'm just about to pick up a collection of essays by Lindy West. She's a feminist writer for the New York Times and super funny. Also reading The Gruffalo, Where the Wild Things Are, and other books that I want to stab myself for having reading every night to my kids.
Right now I'm reading Susan Jacoby. She updated The Age of American Unreason after Trump somehow put this win together. And it's a really interesting rewrite of a book that I read when she released it. I think it first came out in 2008. So that's been really exciting. Also rereading Huck Finn, which is, you know, an American classic. And then Sandra Day O'Connor wrote a book about kind of history and stories from the Supreme Court called Out of Order, which is, it has its moments, but, you know, it's just kind of a little behind the scenes things here and there, traditions, sort of funny stories that she related. So that's been interesting. It's a short one. I definitely would recommend Huck Finn if nobody's read that, or Susan Jacoby's book. She's also a really good friend of FFRF. She agreed to write the foreword of my book if it ever gets published. So she's a really great writer and friend of FFRF. And I think with that, we'll go ahead and wrap it up. Just so you know, FFRF recently launched a new television program called Freethought Matters. FFRF co-presidents Annie Laurie Gaylor and Dan Barker interview freethinkers from across the spectrum, including actress Julia Sweeney, sculptor Zenos Froudakis, scientist and honorary FFRF president Steven Pinker, authors Michelle Goldberg and Katha Pollitt, atheist activists including Marie Schaub and Mariam Namazi, and many more. Freethought Matters is airing on television stations in some markets, but you can watch it right here on Facebook Live at 3 p.m. Central Time on Mondays. That's our new show, Freethought Matters, on Facebook Live at 3 p.m. Central Time on Mondays. And as always, you can catch FFRF's Facebook Live show, Ask an Atheist, which we do every Wednesday at noon Central, on fun topics like open records laws and/or White House Bible studies. So join us next week, and we'll see you then. Thank you.